Come, gentle night. Come, loving, black-browed night. Give me my Lisa, and when she shall die, take her. I cut her out into little stars. And she will make the face of heaven so fine that all the world will be in love with night and pay no worship to the garish sun. Oh, I have bought the mansion of a love, but not possessed it. And though I am sold, not yet enjoyed. So tedious is the day, as is the night before some festival to an impatient child that hath new robes and may not wear them. It just reminded me of my little girl, and I just thought, no worries, I'm just sorry.
That was really beautiful, Beryl.
Great stuff there, Beryl. Great stuff.
Well, I just wanted to say that. You didn't need to sing for me. I could understand everything you're saying, doing your emotion.
Thank you all. That's very kind of you.
No, thank you, Beryl. That was truly powerful. I mean, it's amazing how different interpretations of the same speech can trigger different memories or emotions in us all. That's why Shakespeare's plays are still relevant, I think.
I mean, your connection with Laura's Juliet speech about being a mother made me think about my own childhood. Like, my parents died in a car accident when I was 10, and I was adopted by a lovely white family who loved me just as much as their own children.
They were able to pay for me to go to a fantastic primary school and private school and university, and eventually I was able to get a fantastic job being a financial advisor.
It's just sad that it's taken me this long to truly realise that, you know, you can only survive or thrive in this country. And in order for me to thrive, I had to be accepted and adopt other people's identity cards and reject my own. Everyone in my life, like my family, my friends, work colleagues, and even my girlfriend was white. I mean, there's nothing wrong with that. I love them all, and I've had a rich and fulfilling life, but at what cost? But not being exposed to the culture and history of the people that looked like me, I internalized a false narrative and felt more comfortable around white people. To be accepted, I ignored the racism. I didn't think about me often being the only black person in the room. I had my breakdown because deep down I believed that my identity cards didn't matter. I quit my job, stopped talking to my friends, and
so I broke up with my girlfriend. I couldn't take it anymore. I was tired of hearing jokes about other minorities and wondering what's being said about black people when I'm not there.
Tired of being objectified and having to laugh it off. Tired of having to reassure white people that I'm not a threat. Tired of seeing black people being murdered by the police over and over again. I'm just tired.
I ended up hating myself for enjoying the benefits of a system that is steeped in racism. So before I gave in to suicidal thoughts, I decided to pull away from everything and get my head right. I'm still working on it.
But, you know, creating a safe space like this is definitely a big step in my journey.
Um, Melvin, thanks for sharing that.
Thanks for sharing that, Melvin. Yeah, yeah, that was good.
Thank you. That's enough about me.
It's really wonderful to hear your experiences and what you've gone through. I don't totally know what you're going through, but I resonated with a lot of it. The things you said about race and having to fit your identity into someone else's identity, I related to that from my perspective, and it's generous of you to share that.
Thank you, Laura. Okay, let's wrap this up. Okay. Yeah. Any final words?
I'd just like to say, thank you very much. I think all the Shakespeare stuff has been really, really valuable, and I've really loved listening to everybody's, you know, stories and everything. And I just like the last thing I'd like to share is thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Melvin. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. It's been great. I look forward to next week. Next week's challenge.
I didn't think I needed to be here. My mate kind of forced me to come, and I didn't understand why I was depressed. So it didn't feel real. It didn't feel like a real thing. But listening to all of you have made me sort of realise that the school where I work, because they've not given me the access that I need, it's sort of affecting my job, and that is my dream job, and it's all what I've wanted to do, and I should be happy. I should be really happy, and I'm not. But it's good that I've sort of realised that. So thank you.
Can I go next?
Sure, thanks.
Yeah, I just want to say that I did find it really hard to articulate my feelings into English, because I don't think I have enough grasp of the language or enough vocabulary to be able to express my feelings, if that makes sense. Maybe that's why I enjoy so much, I guess, and no, I hope that's why I do it a lot as well, because I can express my feelings through art. And I think maybe that's why I need like proper BSL support in this community, like qualified BSL interpreters. Like there's no bends to Beryl at all. I just need qualified BSL interpreter that maybe understand this kind of situation. So maybe then I can express myself in BSL, but I know that it's hard to get interpreters because there's lots of lack of funding to get one, and the government doesn't have much, so, yeah.
Thank you for that. I think that is something that I'm going to try to rectify, actually, and thinking about it, being a financial advisor, I know funding, you know, that's what I do. So how about, I don't know exactly who, but I know how, and if I can source some funding and ask you for any recommendations or who you think might be best to contact, then I'm open, and I'm willing to learn, and I apologize again for assuming what you might need. But if you're up for that, I'll text you, and we'll figure this out.
I would love that a lot. Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you.
Just wanted to say, are you okay with me not signing for you from now on, then? You don't need, because I'm aware that I'm not a fully qualified interpreter, and I'm not trained in interpreting for mental health therapy groups. So if you don't need me, then perhaps maybe Malvin, I can come and join you next week as a member, not as an interpreter.
Beryl, that would be an honour.
And also, I just remembered this actually, in my training as a social worker, I learned something about compassion. May I share this?
Please, please.
Well, okay, so it's a triangle, is the model of compassion. And you have to look into yourself to find your compassion for yourself before you can give compassion to another person. So there's the triangle. You're at one angle of the compassion, and there's another way you give compassion to another person. And then the other part of the triangle is you receiving compassion from another person. Now, in order for this triangle to work, all the compassions have to be evenly balanced. So you're not giving compassion, but you're receiving compassion. The balance goes out of sync. So you have to equally have as much compassion for yourself as to giving passion and receiving passion. Does that make sense?
Mm.
I can email you the diagram of how that works, and then you can see it's better in pictorial form. Would that be okay?
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Okay. Yes, I will do that. Yes, and thank you. Thank you for showing me your kindness and accepting me in your group. It's wonderful, wonderful.
Well, I'm looking forward to seeing next week too.
Oh, maybe Dax can create some art of the triangle.
Yeah, I can do that. Yeah.
Amazing. Well, thank you. Thank you all. And I can't wait for next week.
Until next time.
Cheers, Melvin. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. This has been really good.
Bye.
Thank you. Thank you.